Hello, my friends. John LaRuffi here with another Straight Up Solo. And in this episode, we're going to take a look at Skytear Horde, the Monolith Deluxe Edition. And what I'm going to do, because there's a lot of content in here, is I'm going to be using one of the decks that is specific to the Monolith expansion. So this will be the second edition, or second year, so to speak, of this game. Not second edition, but second year. And I'm using the rules incorporated with that. So it will be, I'd say, the most current and latest rule implementation for this game, because I've heard that they're drastically different from year one to year two, so we will display it in that fashion. All right, so let's go ahead and get started. Okay, folks, and as usual, please like and subscribe to my YouTube channel if you haven't already, and if you have, I really appreciate that support. Thank you very much. All right, so a couple things that are nice with the Deluxe Edition. It does come with this playmat, which is just a nicer touch than using the mana bar and just kind of putting things where they belong. Especially since this is a lane-based game, this establishes your five lanes, or your six lanes, pardon me, pretty easily. And when you exhaust, you can slide it into that exhausted slot. I do like that. I will say this, there is a little confusion. The player aids that come with the Deluxe, this one is the actual correct one, but there is one that looks very similar that has information on how you would use the base game with the original rules. And that kind of goofed me up a little bit because it doesn't say that anywhere. And it's like, wait a minute, this doesn't match the rule book at all. What's going on? They should have just left those out. I'm not sure exactly why those were in there. The other thing is that it wasn't completely intuitive how to put it all away as far as where it goes and what are the, you know, how do I set up all the outsiders and things like that. That wasn't easy. It wasn't impossible. I just ended up kind of fumbling my way through it, but you get there. Okay, so what am I doing right now? Well, I am probably about a third of the way through the game, and it doesn't look like a lot's going on, but a lot has already happened. So there's a couple of mechanics in this game. First of all, there's this portal. And the portal summons the Horde cards here according to the number under this little spot here. This, you don't get this, I guess, if you're not playing Deluxe. You just rotate the portal. But I got the Deluxe Edition. So it's going to summon one Horde card this turn. You can destroy stages of the portal. They have this amount of life, which is 6. I've hit it once. And it also tells you how much mana you're supposed to regenerate at the beginning, or generate at the beginning of every turn, in this case 4. The deeper you go, the better the mana generation gets, so you want to do that. Plus, you have to at least destroy stage 1 so that you can put your outsider, your boss, so to speak, into the outsider discard pile, draw pile. And this is the only way you can actually bring this into play in order to try to kill the boss and win the game. Now, you lose the game if your castle takes 20 damage. Right now, it hasn't taken any hits. Or the Horde deck pillages all of your cards out of your draw deck, so you have nothing left to draw. Then you immediately lose. Okay, so those two things can happen. In order to win, you have to beat the outsider itself, the boss. And then you have to survive to the end of the game through the pillage step in the final spot. Now, how does the pillage work? Well, there are these 4 minion cards out here that whenever they have health on them, see, these two guys are effectively not in the game at this moment. But this guy has 1 health token. This guy has 3, which means at the end of the turn, or the end of the round, when I go through the pillage step, I'm going to have to discard 4 cards from here into my discard, unless I draw them in and deal with them. And in the beginning of the game, each of these minions start with at least 1. Maybe the setup has more health on them, depending on how it goes. All right, so let me show you the steps of this game, take you through it, and then I'll tell you what I think about it. So the first thing we do is we go through the Horde phase. We gain mana. So I'm going to gain 4 mana, and I have 1 left over from the previous turn that gives me 5. Then I'm going to summon cards from the Horde deck. In this case, it's 1 based on what's under that purple transparent tiddlywink. And so I get this right here. So I summoned a monster. It's a Swamp Hunter. And it says play. Swamp Hunters charge the closest unengaged ally and deal 1 negative health to it, or 1 damage to it. So that means normally he would go here. Now he's going to charge. He's going to come in here. And he's going to deal a damage to my guy, which is not good because I only have 3 health. And I don't want that to happen. But it happened. So that's a playability. Some cards have playability, some cards don't. Now, if there was anything in that outsider deck, which there isn't, I would summon that too, and then I move this to the next spot over here, effectively just kind of rotating around. So it's going to draw one more next time. Now it is my alliance phase, and that's where I play cards from my hand, and I can use exhaust abilities, and there's also universal exhaust abilities, which some of which are new. So for instance, the one that's new in the Monolith version of this game is that if you exhaust your castle, you can spend one mana to draw a card from the deck, where you used to not be able to do that. The only way else you could draw a card from the deck regularly is if every time you kill a monster, and that also includes killing a minion, but not a token monster. Whenever you kill a monster or a minion, you will draw one card from the deck, and that's the main way you get more. Now, the mana cost is in the upper left-hand corner. I have five, so let's see what I've got. I have two spells and a heroic ally. Well, I'm most likely going to pull out the heroic ally because these guys are like the champions in my deck, right? This guy costs two, and it says, spells in your hand gain this alternate effect. So I can play it during the treachery phase, and when I do, this guy deals an amount of damage to a monster within two, deals amount of negative damage within a monster two lanes equal to this card's mana cost. Okay, so that would be two hits. So that's actually not bad at all. I'm going to bring him out for sure. So I'll drop this down to three, put him over here, because it's within two lanes. So that means that here and here, as far as I read within two lanes, I would be able to deal damage all over the place, and that could really help, okay? And that's a spell in my hand. It gains, so I could basically play this one. Instead of doing this turn, castle gains, blah, 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 I could do this, which I like. And that is equal to the card's mana cost. So if I wanted to, I could even save this one right here. Spend that, do three, and kill him without even having to lose this ally, which I probably will. Okay, that is cool. I like that. All right, now, so I played him. I may save this, but this one also says, play this, when you play it, this turn the castle gains, after you play a spell, summon a troop token with play, mutiform one, which isn't bad, because what that means is that I can give a troop token right here, one of mine, either plus one attack permanently, or plus one health permanently. So that's not bad either, but I think I want to get rid of this, and so we're going to keep that in mind. The other thing you could do in this game is in order to engage at these minions, you can exhaust a card like this, and it will bring in one of the minions like this. Now, I'm not going to do that because it would kill this guy, and this guy's way better, way more worth it for me to do, to keep him alive and do that mana casting. You can also exhaust any cards like these tower cards that have certain things that allow you to do different things here. I'm not going to do that right now for this playthrough. And then you can, when you want to move them, if I wanted to move this guy to a different lane, I would just exhaust him and move him to a different lane. Or I can even exhaust two cards and swap them. So those are all the things that you can do in order to, basically move your cards around, etc. in this alliance phase. Okay, now, the alliance phase is done. Now we go to the treachery phase where I flip over a card and I figure out what happens. So this has an attack. What this means is it'll be one temporary attack. This is the only thing you worry about the treachery phase is the symbols over here. It's going to give this guy a plus one temporary attack over here, which really won't matter because he's going to kill him anyway. So that doesn't matter too much to me. And sometimes it goes to the rightmost monster, sometimes it goes to the leftmost monster, and sometimes the treachery is some type of spell like this. See, this is a lightning bolt that says pillage two cards. So when I draw that, I've got to deal with that pillage where I lose more in my deck. Now, I can play any of these special exhaust abilities that have the lightning bolt to it, which this one now is where it comes into play, because I would need to play. So I would need to activate this in order to do this right now during the treachery phase and only during the treachery phase. You may exhaust abilities and or play cards with that play. Yes. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to spend three mana, one, two, three, to play this card in order to deal three damage to him and not allow him to be killed. And I don't know why I said he was going to kill him before, because that was my plan. But there we go. So I just basically wiped him out because he has 3 health and he's gone. So that's good. Now, because I killed him, I get to draw another card. Okay. So now we get to the fight phase. And in the fight phase, any horde card or your card will resolve its fight ability if it has a fight on it. Okay. Now, nothing out here does, but it would resolve that first him, then me, and then we simultaneously attack, dealing our damage. And sometimes there's defense tokens and all the usual trappings you'd expect of a game like this. Since there is nothing like this, I can start piling on my damage onto the onto this card right here and move it forward. Or I could have, as I said before, exhausted previously and brought in these minions and dealt with them. But I don't. I need to make some progress here, and that's what I'm going to do. So this is going to attack the portal for 2, and he is going to attack the portal for 2. So that's 2, 4. So 4, and then I already have the -1 over there. So now he's 5. So he is 1 damage away from going through that stage and getting me to the next stage, okay? Now, this tower over here does not have a specific attack or a defense. It's more like, I don't know what you want to call it. It's like an auxiliary card that does its own thing. It's not an ally card. It's not a spell. All right, and so that is the whole turn. And then the end phase, I'd remove any temporary tokens if I had them out here, which would be temporary attack or temporary defense. Then I would ready any exhausted cards. And then I would discard down to 7 if I have more than 7 cards in my hand, which is very unlikely, and then I'd start another turn. And that is the flow of the game. So basically, you're going to be continuing to do this until you win or you lose, and it takes about a half hour usually to get to that spot. It's not a very long game, and so you can kind of set it up pretty quickly based on the rules of how the setup goes, and it also helps. This divider really helps things. Again, this is the deluxe box, but it definitely helps speed up the setup pretty quickly. So you can get it to the table, you can knock it out, you can play it, and then you can play again, or you can do different things, etc. So a couple more things I'll mention. When you get this deluxe version, it will come with 2 of the decks of each color. So there's 2 blue, 2 red, there's 2 yellow. I'm playing with one of the yellow decks. The other one's kind of hiding in here. All right, and then 2 green, okay? You can also deck build, and the deck building is a little bit different than usual deck building games, and I'll point that out right here, where you're allowed to mix and match different colored decks depending on what it says here. So it tells you, you can have 2 legendary, maximum of 6 mythic of this card, of the yellow, and then any base or rare cards of those types. So rare cards of yellow and red, base types of yellow, red, and green. So it's a little more forgiving, and you have to have the one guy, in this case him, in there, and then 39 other cards. You can't have any extra, you can't have any less, because that pillage ability is a big factor in this game. Oh, speaking of pillage ability, I skipped the pillage phase. So after I finish that fight, I have to do 1, 2, 3, 4 pillages to my deck. 1, 2, 3, and 4. And those are gone unless I can get some rebuild actions, which there are spells that let you do that, and other abilities that let you take cards, put them back on the bottom of your deck, kind of extend your deck a little bit. So we've got that ability, that part of the game. You also have a ton of, in this box, a ton of different horde decks you can play with. So it comes with, again, this is the full, like, year 1, year 2 content, the whole thing. It comes with 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 different horde decks to play with, which is a lot. Now, those don't mix and match, but what you can do with those is that you can customize the difficulty based on the types of cards that you want to play. So they give you a chart in here, and the cards are all color-coded, and I'll show you the chart real quick, that you can basically set it up. And I'm playing on level 2. I found level 2 was a pretty good place to start. I've won some, I've lost some. It's helped me really get an understanding of what the game's about. You get 18 cards in the deck, so you get a variety of different things. But as you go to different levels, the cards get harder, and sometimes there's less frequent of them. So this one's only a 10-card deck, but you also you have a very hard card in there and some more challenging ones. And then you have a level four, which is 20 cards. And then level five, which is all the tough cards. So you can customize this game for the experience you're looking for pretty easily. And I think that's very helpful and very handy. And it gives it some good longevity in its plays. So those are all of the things I can do to explain the game. Let me tell you my final thoughts and what I think about it. Okay, so this game, if you like lane battling style games like this, this game does a very good job giving you plenty to do from a solo perspective. It is very easy to play. It's not complicated. The rulebook has a little vagaries here and there, but for the most part, the more you play, I think the, and if you kind of, I want to say is if you don't spend too long on the vagaries, you'll sort of pick it up as you go because other cards kind of make it more obvious. For instance, barrier. For whatever reason, I was stuck on barrier. I couldn't figure out barrier. And then all of a sudden I realized, oh, okay, this is what barrier is saying. It's saying that no matter how many damage, if the thing is undamaged, no matter how many damage it takes the first time, it just gets one damage. From there on in, it goes normally. I don't know why I had a hard time struggling with that. That's what it basically said in the rule book, but it took me a couple plays for that to sink in for whatever reason with different cards. Don't know. Maybe it's just me. For the most part, the rule book is pretty well laid out. It helps you get into the game pretty quickly, and it's not a very tough game to learn, and it flows. It flows nicely. It flows quickly, and you get to experience a lot of different things in this game. It's the way the pillaging works and the way the castle damage works are interesting. Now, you notice in my playthrough there, not playthrough, but my game, I hadn't taken any castle damage. That's because a lot of the cards that are coming up here, I was dealing with before they could damage me. But it was also killing my allies and different things. But what I was doing is I was starting to being, you know, chipped away pretty quickly by that pillage mechanic. And I like that because the pillage mechanic, unlike just a normal lane battler where, you know, things stack up and you get in trouble, the pillage mechanic forces you to start bringing in monsters, those minions, and dealing with them to stop your deck from basically bleeding to death, which I think is cool because the game itself doesn't have, it's not like you have to beat a monster that's got 50 health like in order to win. You know, most of the actual outsiders are crafty and clever in a way that they don't necessarily take a ton of damage. The one actually that I had in this game is going to take 10 damage to defeat, but that's one of the higher ones. A lot of times they have a lot of different things going on, so you're kind of juggling and managing different things in order to find the right time to make a strike. And it may only take one or two or three good strikes to get rid of them. And so I like that because it provides a bit more of a cerebral puzzle, so to speak, than just I'm gonna beef up my guy, I'm gonna line him up, I'm gonna get him in there, and I'm just gonna and be done, you know. And sometimes lane battlers, at least I've played a lot of them online and such, they kind of feel like they degrade into that and it gets a little boring. This doesn't have that feel. Plus, you can mix and match any outsider you want with any horde deck, so you can effectively just play with outsiders you like and skip ones that you don't like if there's mechanics or things you find annoying. But you can keep with the horde decks that can bring out variety of what else you're dealing with. Just a very customizable game, and I think they did a really good job there. Now, the game is expensive if you get the full all-in deal like I did. And I did that, it's funny, I did that mostly because I wanted all the content, but I really wanted the organization of the box and the cards and everything to go with it with the playmat. And it just seemed like the best value, but it was expensive. So be careful to know that this is what you're looking for. It's a lane battler, right? But it's a lane battler in an interesting way that provides some different stuff going on. What I probably will do in the future is I'll probably do a few playthroughs of different, like full playthroughs of games and different decks. And I'm not gonna do that just yet because I'm making this video first, but there's probably a lot here. I've played it several times. I felt like in each game, each deck I played, and each horde I went up with was a dramatically different feel on what's going on, with the exception that you're always dealing with that pillager situation. But some of them spend a lot of time beefing up those pillagers a lot more, and some of them just kind of norm and just they're dicing away at your castle or they're doing other things. So it's just a really interesting, very flexible and very unique spin, I guess, on the ability to play a lane battler solo. The other thing is I find that all of the player decks, even out of the box, feel very different from one another. They're not different in the fact that you've never seen this before, but they're not just, you know, more of the same. Well, this one is pretty similar to that one. You kind of feel like you would expect it to feel, where there's decks that do that you are, you know, all about speed, and decks that are all about miscellaneous stuff, and decks that are all about pumping up smaller allies, and then some that do true. But they're definitely different. They're definitely different. You don't have this whole feel like it almost doesn't. It's just a little bit of flavor here or there. I got different champions here or there, but the rest of the cards are similar. No. They are. I think there's a lot of good thought, well thought out, interesting decks to explore here before you even start building. And then when you build, I do like how they did the deck building in this game, where you have a lot of cross functionality. So let's say you don't want to get into everything right away. You could probably buy just the year two monolith stuff with maybe an expansion and do really well to kind of build some unique decks, not have to go with the year one side of things. But I do think, as everybody says, that the monolith rules are the best rules to play with. And certainly I didn't play with the old rules, but what you do have here in here seems very good. I don't have any gripes about the system. And there, I also saw some say, well, you know, they could get bad card draws and such. You do get a mulligan, okay? So that's the first thing. If you have a bad card draw, take a mulligan. And if it really didn't go well again, like if it's really bad, then just reshuffle and deal with what you've got. Now, the idea that you can have a horde deck come up and grease you right away, I haven't felt that yet. Maybe there is there. But in the games I've played, that I haven't felt like, oh, that's it. I've drawn that one card and it's over. I mean, maybe it's there, and people have said that, but I haven't stumbled upon that yet. And maybe there's that has to do more with the higher difficulties. Like, I don't feel that in the level two difficulty. Maybe it'd be more in the level four difficulty. I don't know. But I don't think it's a stumbling block in order to get into the game and feel like you're going to get just clobbered if you don't want to go on the higher difficulty levels. I've never felt like I was just overwhelmed. I felt like I didn't have the right strategy to win. I've had that happen. And that's a good thing, because that's like, well, if I study this and do this a little bit better, next time I'll try this and that will be easier to deal with it. Or maybe if I'm going against this particular horde, I need a different deck, or I might want a different deck. It might be an easier experience because I can deal with the problems more readily. So lots of good stuff there. All right, I don't want to ramble anymore. Apologize for that, but I think it's a good game. I really do. If you like lane attack games like this, this one does a great job doing it solo. And even though there's competitive and cooperative rules in the box, those are there. But I think the solo is great. I wouldn't even worry about playing with other people, period. It's a very well, good thought out game. And I think it's nice. It doesn't overstay its welcome. It doesn't feel like it drags. It doesn't feel like it's too fast. It's perfect in its length and in what you're doing with it. So thanks again for watching. I really appreciate the support from everybody. And as I always say, whatever you do in the future, I really, really hope you have a fantastic time doing it. Take it easy, everybody.